Well, as many of you know, I've just returned from France, so allow me to say bonjour mes amis en Christ. And coming from France, of course, with those of you who've been to outside of this country, basically, to countries where people seem to take a little bit more time to enjoy life, it becomes clearer coming back here that we really are a nation of workaholics. But unlike other addictions, we freely admit to the addiction of work. Many of us seem to wear it as a badge of honor. Yet, as we see from our readings this morning, God did not create us to work without ceasing. Remember the Sabbath and keep it holy. It's one of the 10 commandments, not the 10 suggestions. God wants us to have Sabbath time, a time to put aside the demands of daily living and rest. Just as God rested after creating the world in 6 days, we too are commanded to rest. But why? Why is Sabbath rest so important that God would include it in one of only 10 non-negotiables that we follow as the 10 commandments? And why do we have such a hard time accepting that Sabbath is important? Now, when I was growing up, my parents were members of the World War II generation, commonly known as the Great Generation, and they and their peers had a very strong work ethic. My parents were British, and I went to bed very early, so I spent a lot of time. We had this routine after dinner, like bath time, bed, 6:30, it would still be light out, but I digress. I would be lying in my room for hours on end, listening to them talk. And they would always, every night, complain about how hard they had worked that day. And they never got tired of doing that. But there was also a lot of judgment of others based on how hard the perception of how hard they worked. And so from this, I know that I internalized a very strong work ethic myself. On the positive side, I learned how to set goals and then to work to reach them. But on the negative side, in the back of my mind, no matter how hard I work, I have a nagging feeling that I'm never working hard enough. There's always more that I could be doing. Does anybody else feel like this? Yeah, exactly. Well, God's message to us this morning is as important to me as it is for anyone else here. God requires us to rest. But I ask again, why is this so important? So, as I said at the beginning, I've just returned from France where we were on a pilgrimage, so we had a reason to be there beyond pure enjoyment. However, I must be honest with you, it's impossible not to enjoy oneself in the south of France. Everywhere you look, there are outdoor cafes and people sitting in them at all hours of the day, wasting time. And my sense is that no one feels too guilty about it. But we were on a pilgrimage. We did have goals of one sort or another, maybe nothing written down. And you might justifiably ask, what is a pilgrimage exactly? Well, Christian writer Macrina Whitaker writes, "A pilgrimage is a ritual journey with a hallowed purpose. Every body to be understood. A pilgrimage is not a vacation. It's a transformational journey during which significant changes take place. New insights are given. Deeper understanding is attained. New and old places in the heart are visited. Blessings are received, and healing takes place. On return from the pilgrimage, life is seen with different eyes. Nothing will be quite the same again. In a nutshell, a pilgrimage involves travel, but it is more than mere travel. It entails an expectation. You set out with an expectation of a deeply meaningful experience. And it's grounded in religious faith so that these experiences take on a different, deeper meaning as you go through them. The classic book, A Pilgrim's Progress, written by John Bunyan in 1678, is an allegory for the life of any Christian. And it informs us that any life for a Christian is a pilgrimage, because we imbue it with religious meaning. But the trouble is, we forget that, don't we? We get caught up in the business of our lives, in the dominant illusion that we're actually in control. And we must therefore prioritize our work, our ability to impact the world. But the sad thing is, when we do this, we are really cheating ourselves out of God's good gift of Sabbath. And we are cheating ourselves out of an opportunity just to let it all go and to remember that we are not in charge at all. That role is taken by God. So the Sabbath, as the people of the Old Testament lived it, was a time to remember all the ways that God had blessed the beloved people, the chosen people, in the past. And why would that be important, to remember all the ways that you've been blessed in the past? Why would that be important? Well, my theory is it's important because it gives us confidence that we, no matter how bad things seem in the present time, God will be there for us, now and in the future. When we give thanks to God for the ways that we've been blessed, for God's love and mercy, we can gain blessed freedom from anxiety, fear, and insecurity about the future. Let's fast forward a few thousand years. Today, the Sabbath is still a time to acknowledge our dependence on God and to allow ourselves to relax into God's love for us. Allow ourselves not to do, but simply to be. Be still and know that I am God, God says. And this is a good mantra to have ourselves on our Sabbath day, at least once a week, maybe every day. Take some Sabbath time to pray that prayer. Be still and know that I am God. Now, in Mark's gospel today, Jesus comes into conflict with those from his faith tradition who take a more legalistic view of the Sabbath. And we're told that he's grieved by their hardness of heart, because instead of receiving the Sabbath as it was meant, with its intention of love, God's unconditional love and care for God's people, these religious legalists have turned it into another piece of work to accomplish, another thing to check off of the to-do list. Honored my father and mother? Check. Did not tell a lie? Check. Didn't do any work on the Sabbath? Check. They're not really looking at the deeper meaning of the Sabbath, and Jesus tells them it was created for humankind. It was created for us. We don't have to worry about offending God by helping others on the Sabbath. How many times have you been in having an experience that is supposed to be wonderful, like the Sabbath? Maybe it's Christmas time. And you go into it with all these expectations of what Christmas is meant to be like a legalistic view of Christmas. And you get there and then experience something goes wrong. The presents aren't right. Someone drank too much. The turkey was overcooked. Christmas is ruined. We all have this tendency to have these expectations of things that are meant to be fun, they're meant to be life-giving. And Jesus' point is, you're taking the fun out of Sabbath. You're taking the life-giving aspect of the meaning of taking time out to remember God's goodness. Now, God invites us to realize that all of life is a holy pilgrimage on which endless wonders await us, endless insights, endless opportunities for transformation in our daily lives. We don't know what's going to happen in the next hour after we leave here. It could be something amazing. It all has to do with how we interpret what God sends us and the holiness that exists all around us. If we're able to have these eyes to see our lives through that lens of a pilgrimage, when we take time to notice all of God's abundant blessings in life, it makes our lives not just magical, but transformed and transcendent.